Hello and welcome everyone to the Cross Cultural Couples Podcast. My name is Erica El Halali.
And I'm Hamada El Halali.
And today we're going to be talking about a very important topic. And this one isn't even important just for your relationships. It's really important for your whole life purpose. And that is the topic of Dharma. So, I know a lot of people have heard about karma, and there's all these cultural references to karma. I think karma itself is a very complex topic, so we won't get too much into that. But specifically, Dharma is related to what is your soul's unique purpose. And this is a belief that every single soul has a specific purpose of how their soul can uniquely help humanity, which I personally find very beautiful. This is not a topic that's necessarily from my cultural background or Hamana's cultural background, but it's something that we both really think is true and is something that is where we can kind of meet on a common ground and help support each other's dharma in the context of our relationship. So we're going to talk about dharma. Hamada, what are your thoughts on dharma?
Honestly, I grew up not knowing what dharma is. And so, like, I started researching and you start teaching me about dharma. And dharma is basically what I understood from it is what's your purpose in life? Like, what are you supposed to be doing in your life? Are you supposed to be a teacher? Are you supposed to be a singer? Are you supposed to be an athlete? Are you supposed to be a cook? I think that's what dharma is. And for us, we just have to find what is your dharma.
Yeah, and I do think that a lot of people think of it in terms of, like, what is my career path? Because there are a lot of career paths that fit really nicely into certain types of dharma archetypes. And definitely your dharma can be expressed in different ways in your career. But I think that's a really good distinction to make. It's not necessarily just a career path. It's much bigger than that. It's really what is your mission to serve humanity. And you can serve humanity in a lot of different ways that don't necessarily involve just a specific career. And then just as far as how I got really into Dharma and where I got exposure to it, when we moved to California, I started listening to a podcast called The Highest Self Podcast with Sahara Rose. I highly recommend that podcast. It's absolutely amazing. And she actually wrote a book called Discovering Your Dharma. And then she also has a coaching institute called the Dharma Coaching Institute. And I actually am part of their inaugural class of Dharma coaches. So I am working to become a certified Dharma coach. And with that, I've been learning a ton about Dharma, about doshas, koshas, about different ways you can, your dharma can be expressed. And so for me, this has been something, especially after the pandemic, I think all of us have been really looking on a deeper level. We've been reflecting throughout 2020 and even into 2021 as far as, you know, who are we as a society, but then who are we as souls? What is our own specific soul's purpose? I think we've all been confronted with the mortality of life, that life isn't permanent. We're only here for a short amount of time. And so what do we want to do with the rest of our life? How do we want to be of service to humanity, to others, to the planet? How can we best use these days to really serve to the highest level we can? And I think a lot of people, when they think of that, they'll think, oh, I have to be like Mother Teresa or give up all my worldly possessions and become a monk or something like that. And especially coming from a Catholic upbringing. My confirmation saint was Francis of Assisi, and he was born into wealth, and he gave up all of his money and helped animals and the poor and everything. And so I think that's a tradition that I've grown up with, and I think now I'm really realizing that's not the only way to serve. You don't just have to give up on the material world to serve. A lot of times, if you have abundance, if you have material wealth, you can do a lot to serve humanity with that in different ways, and it doesn't make you, there isn't a guilt associated with that. And so I think I struggled growing up with this kind of dichotomy between you either can be a capitalist and go out and make money, or you can be good and like give up all your money and serve the poor. And both of those are extremes. I think there's a very healthy medium we can all find our purpose in.
Yeah, you're right.
So we're gonna talk about, in this specific episode, I thought it would be helpful to talk about the nine Dharma archetypes, and all of these are from the book that Sahara Rose wrote, Discovering Your Dharma. I highly recommend this book. It gives you a very straightforward way to start thinking about Dharma, to start laying it out. And I mean, there's a lot of complexity that goes into it. As I've gone through the coaching, I've learned even more layers to it. But I think that it's a good place to start to even see what are the archetypes, are there ways that you may fit into these? And so this kind of can help you start to identify, are there different paths for me to take?
Cool. So,
So, Hamada, do you want to read the nine Dharma archetypes?
yeah, the nine Dharma archetypes are the first one is the teacher, the second one is the
The nurturer.
nurturer, the third one is the visionary, the fourth one is the entrepreneur, the fifth one is the artist, the sixth one is the researcher, the seventh one is the entertainer. The eighth one is the activist, and the nine is the warrior. Which one do you think you are, Erica?
So me, I think everybody's a combination of all of them. Like, we all have a little bit of warrior, a little bit of researcher, all these things. We all have a certain extent of all of these in our capacity as a human. But I think we tend to have some more dominant types that we will be towards. When I really started looking at this, I realized that growing up, I totally identified as the researcher. I was all about knowledge, exploring the world, everything, really trying to get that deep understanding of what the world was, very confident in academia and all of that. And as I've grown, especially as I've become a mother, I've realized the nurturer is also very, very predominant, especially when it comes to connections and relationships. That's something that's very, very important to me. And I think it was not something I always honored in myself. And so now that I'm aging, I'm getting more comfortable with that. I also think I have a bit of the visionary as well. So those are the main three that I am. And I think for you're actually the artist and the entertainer. And
Really?
so Hamada is always making music now, and even before that, he would paint. He's always more that artistic soul, and he's also an entertainer as well. So I think that those are more what your archetypes are.
Cool. Yeah, I
So
think
we'll.
that's what I am.
Yeah, we'll go through each one and give you some examples for each one just to kind of get us all started here. And we did have an episode previously on the doshas. If you want to go back and look at that, it's like doshas and relationships. You can look at that if you identify as a certain dosha. That may also help you identify which archetype you may be. It's not always apples to apples though. For example, the researcher tends to be a Vata dosha. I am not a Vata. I'm more of a Pitta Kapha, but I do have Vata tendencies when it comes to the researcher part of me. So, I will go through each archetype, the dharma, the dosha, and then how it may show up in others. So, the teacher is the first one, and they're really here to share through knowledge. They tend to have the vata kapha dosha. They're here to teach the experiences they undergo. So, for example, they normally have to experience something before they feel comfortable teaching it. So maybe they had an issue with acne, or like they had a skin problem. They had eczema or something like that. And through different nutrition practices, they were able to cure that. And then they want to teach people that. So then they'll go out and teach people how to have, better diet to help with their skin. Or they may just be, even in a corporation, they may be people who they were in a role and then they really like to train people, or they teach the customer how to use a product, or they teach new hires or learning and development consultant, things like that. So, and then obviously the teacher is very heavily in the school system. You'll see that all kinds of teachers are here throughout education as well. But this specific archetype doesn't have to be just only reserved for teachers in a school. I think teachers can come in a lot of different forms. The second archetype is the nurturer, and they're really here to care and connect. So these are people that they like to hold space for people. They're very, very, you feel like a warm energy with them. They'll make you feel comfortable. The dosha associated with them is the kapha dosha. And how they show up, they are highly empathic, and they really can feel exactly what the person needs. So if the person, if somebody, a friend or somebody they're with needs a shoulder to cry on, they'll be there for them that way. If somebody needs just a longer conversation to really process something, they'll be there. They won't judge the person. They'll let them just get everything out. So these people tend to make really good coaches, counselors, just friends. These are very good in relationships. Like this archetype specifically loves to care and connect. They will have issues though with boundaries and things like that. So some of these, there's a lot of pluses too, but then there can be downsides to the archetype itself. I think that the nurturer is really important for society as a whole. I mean, if we don't have nurturers, we don't have people connecting and helping people through tough times. So these people can serve humanity in a lot of different ways, but they won't necessarily be ways that are always easily identifiable in like the corporate structure of jobs that we have. You'll see them a lot with customer service, with account management, anytime where they can be connecting with customers, be connecting with people, building those connections, they do really well. And they also do really well in professions where they're helping people, they're serving people, maybe in a time of need, or they're just there to help people, if they're a counselor, go through a hard time. The visionary archetype is really here to be a bridge for the new paradigm. So they tend to have vata and pitta, and they express the visions that come through them through the gifts of words. So you'll see people who are on podcasts a lot of times, or writing books, or
Speech people.
speaking. Yeah, so they like to get their ideas out normally through words, and they like to bring new ideas. So sometimes you'll see people who, you'll see this in the spiritual community a lot. But then you'll also see it even in business and technology. You'll see this with people who like to come up with new innovations, new ideas. These are people that like to look at new ways of looking at things. It's not even just coming up with like a new product. What they really want to do is come up with a whole new way of thinking of things. So you may see a visionary who is coming up with a new system, or they're coming up with a new approach to a problem. So maybe for a long time we've done manufacturing one way, and then they completely turn it on its head and do it a totally different way. So these are very highly creative people, but they want to make sure that whatever their new ideas are getting out there in the world and expressed in some sort of way, normally through words.
Like Elon Musk, maybe? Elon Musk for Tesla? You know
Yeah,
all these?
he's probably a combination. Well, he has researcher in him too, and then probably visionary and entrepreneur. So we'll get to the entrepreneur next. There are some distinctions between the visionary and entrepreneur. We'll get into the entrepreneur next right now. The entrepreneur is here to address the problems of society through a business solution. So they tend to be very pitta, and the entrepreneurs thrive on coming up with a solution that no one else has thought of. So Elon Musk is a great example in the fact that he actually, saw that obviously there's a huge problem with renewable energies or relying on fossil fuels. So then he came up with Tesla and really drove battery technology for electric vehicles.
So the battery technology, talking about Tesla, is the innovation that they came up with, is the battery itself that holds the power for a long time, right?
Well, and I mean, that's where he's kind of that mix of he wants to be a researcher and figure out what's going on, and then he uses that to come up with a new vision and then bring that vision to market through a business solution is the entrepreneur. So, entrepreneurs are really romanticized right now, and at least in American culture. I think Shark Tank, and I mean, even Elon Musk, like a lot of these entrepreneurs that we see just have very almost like rock star status. Think of like Richard Branson or whatever. I think that especially it's just part of American culture to really romanticize this archetype. These tend to be very, very driven people. They have that pitta energy. They will get an idea. They know what they want to do with it, and they'll bring it to market. I will say though, you don't have to be the entrepreneur archetype to ever start your own business. So maybe you are in the teacher mode, and but then you come, maybe you do come up with an idea, and you use, you teach people a new class online or whatever. You don't have to only be an entrepreneur to start a business, but entrepreneurs tend to like starting businesses. There may be entrepreneurs too who need the security of a job, so maybe they, whatever, at different points of their life, they need a stable income. They may go work for a company, and then while they're at that company, they want to be in product management. They want to try to develop new solutions to a product. They may be in sales and want to go out and get more sales. There can be a lot of different ways that archetype will get expressed. I think business in America in general is very open to the entrepreneur archetype, and you have a lot of career paths available to you. Now we'll talk about the artist. The artist is here to create beauty. Their dosha is Vata. They tend to be channels of divine expression through art, song, design, poetry, or dance. They are also more they have that curiosity, but it's more about life in general. They want to really understand and reflect for people and really make things beautiful. So you'll see this come up in a lot of different ways. You'll see the traditional artists that we think of, like the musicians. You'll see dancers, writers, things like this in this archetype. But then you may see it as people who want to go into marketing and create really beautiful branding or color combinations, things like that. Whatever they go into, they'll have an element of beauty to it.
Because they're an artist and they are creative and they come up with new ideas of the world and new design if you're a designer, new song if you're a singer. So they're just mostly creative, right?
Yeah, I mean, and there's really a difference between coming up with an innovation to bring to market. There's very much in the entrepreneur side, it's like we have to get this to market. It's solving a problem. The artist wants whatever creative idea they're coming up with to be beautiful. So there's a whole branch of philosophy called aesthetics, but it really gets into the beauty of life and making the world more a more beautiful place for all of us. So how they serve is they want to make the world more beautiful for people, which, I mean, if we didn't have artists, the world would be a lot more dull. So this is a great, absolutely fabulous archetype.
know.
And then the researcher is here to understand the ways of the world on a deep level. They also tend to be Vata. They're extremely curious and they carry a childlike curiosity with them throughout life. That's something I've had my whole life. I've had a very childlike
I think you
curiosity.
are a researcher because you're always curious about stuff.
And I will always, like, I don't know how researchers did it before they lived in a time of Google, because I'm constantly Googling stuff, figuring stuff out, trying to get, get the information on it. So it's really the age of the researcher in a lot of ways. I mean, we have all these amazing resources we can use as researchers that we never had before.
You can have a question and literally like after 5 minutes you have like hundreds and hundreds of answers.
Yeah, well, and they that childlike curiosity is something that you'll see for them well into their adult years. So this one is a archetype that you'll see with people who maybe when they were younger they were a little nerdy. They wanted to always know what was happening with school and stuff like that. Not always though. Some people they didn't like school. School may have been too structured for them. But they are people who want to constantly be learning and figuring out on a deeper level what is the world. They may focus on a specific topic and really get in depth with that. So, maybe they become a professor, maybe they become a medical doctor, things like that. This can also be used in the corporate world if you're somebody who now we have like data scientists. So these are people who are analyzing data, looking at trends, things like that. They'll find new ways to understand the world. The next one is the entertainer, and this is somebody who's here to make you laugh, cry, smile, gasp, ponder, and every emotion in between. So they really want to make you feel. And this is pretty much all the doshas, Vata, Pitta, Kapha. They're deeply fascinated by the human psyche and go deep into character to understand the world from a new lens. So actors are this, but you'll even see it a lot of times, like in the business world, you may see it with salespeople. They may almost like be putting themselves in character when they're going to do a sales pitch or something like that. So these they may be funny, they may be humorous, or you may have an entertainer that's here to make you feel deeper emotion. So maybe it's not always, we think of entertaining as like a comedian. It's not always the case. I think Kamada has this, like it comes through in your music, your acting. But then I feel like you're more of an artist overall just because you have this with everything he does, like whether we're looking at designing a room or anything, it always has, there has to be like a certain beauty to it. So.
You think so?
Yeah, I see that in you.
I guess.
The next one is the activist. These ones are here to bring social, environmental, or political change. They're pittas. Activists see the world as co a cohesive being where all people are intertwined. So, I mean, we've all seen activists, I think, at some point in our life. I think some of us may have activist phases at different points in our life. I know certainly there's been times in my life where I'm more politically activated than others. And I normally will be in that zone, but it doesn't necessarily feel comfortable or right with my soul because at the heart of myself, I want to connect with people. And I feel like sometimes when you're in the activist mode, you're not building those connections all the time, at least for me, doesn't feel natural. So this is a great, great archetype, though. These are people who push society forward. They point out political injustice. They point out environmental issues, social inequalities. So these are very important for the progress of society. So you'll see, you know, people involved in politics in this archetype. You'll see people, though, even, you know, maybe you're a lawyer and you fight for environmental causes. Maybe you're somebody working for social justice reform. Any kind of person in that vein. Because we're a democracy, I think at some point we all sometimes will get into the activist role. I think it depends on the degree to injustice that we're seeing. So certain things may trigger us to get into this more than others. And then the last archetype is the warrior, and they're here to protect. This is a Pitta archetype. Warriors have strong opinions and a deep sense of what is right or wrong. And warriors are, you'll see this also in like athletes and people who want to go into the police or military.
Really?
They really feel like the way that they can serve people is to protect them. And I think in this is probably getting a little too in the weeds of it, but at certain points in my own past life, I think I was in warrior positions, and that's not necessarily my natural comfort of where my soul really is. So sometimes I feel myself getting into that warrior mode, and I'm like, nope, that's not really my role. I'm not a protector. I'm a nurturer. I'm here to connect people, to learn about things as a researcher. Those are things where I feel more authentically myself. So you may find yourself going into different archetypes at different times, depending upon, you know, what's called on you. You know, nurturer, obviously, if you're in a motherly role, if you're in a parenting role as a father, you may drop into the nurturer. It may not feel as comfortable to you, so you may say, well, obviously, I'm going to nurture my child, but I'm really an entrepreneur. I want to be out starting a business, coming up with a new idea. Maybe you're the artist and you really want to do something beautiful, and you can combine things. So maybe you, one of the ways you nurture is, you know, connecting with your kid through painting or something like that, or music or whatever it is. So there's different roles that we play in our day-to-day life, so we may have to take on different archetypes, but there's probably, you know, a couple of these or a few of these that you're gonna feel more authentically aligned with. So these are the 9 archetypes. We went through them pretty quickly. There's a lot more information if you check out Sahara Rose's book, Discover Your Dharma. I also am in the coaching, Dharma Coaching Institute. So for our listeners, I will be offering a free 30-minute introduction to the Dharma archetypes, where we can talk about what is your Dharma archetype, how that may show up for you, either in your relationships or with your career. And I wanted to offer that to my listeners first before anybody else. So if that's something you're interested in, please reach out to me on Instagram. Our Instagram profile is at crossculturalcouples, or you can reach out to my personal Instagram at Erica L. Halali, E-R-I-C-A. E-L-H-I-L-A-L-I. And I would love to set up a 30-minute session with you. We can find a time that works for both of us, and we can go through what your archetype is, how that can relate and help you either in your relationship. So if it's you and your partner and you want to figure out what your archetypes are, or if it's in a career setting, I'm fine with that too. I want to make it as easy for you as possible. And this is a free session only available to you while I'm still in training. Once I'm certified this fall, this will no longer be available. So reach out to me before September. And I really do think that these archetypes are really helpful to helping you understand yourself. What is your purpose? And then when you can go back and connect with your partner about it, it gives you a way to say, okay, how do I support my partner? So if my partner's really an artist, how can I really honor that? Can I, maybe if he's the artist, he should be doing some of the furniture buying. He has a better eye than I do. Or maybe you have somebody who is a visionary and they need to get their ideas out there. Maybe you give them some time to figure out writing or whatever they want to do. There's a lot of different ways you can help support each of these archetypes. And when your partner's aligned with their dharma and you're aligned with your dharma, it's pretty magical to even be in that type of relationship space where you're really supporting and helping each other work towards your dharmas. You're trying to lift each other up that way. I think that puts your relationship at really the highest level possible, where you're really connected and you're honoring each other's soul's purpose.
I agree, but by knowing your partner's dharma, that will help you like ease in the relationship more and support each other, like you said.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, so feel free to reach out to us. Reach out to me again on Instagram, if you're interested in a free session regarding your archetype. And feel free to reach out to us if you guys have any questions or want us to go over a specific topic. We love connecting with you guys, and we're very, very happy to continue this podcast, and we appreciate you guys continuing to listen to us. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you so much and have a great day, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.